college, where we might share time at different, starting in January. So that's something that's in the pipeline. And if faculty from the other areas are interested in sort of a collaborative event, we're ready to do that. We just wanted to get this off the ground because we have graduate students and we have faculty that have been working on research over the last year with graduate students. And we want to be able to allow the faculty more to talk about that work. So in the short term, the doctorate will, this month will of course be Dr. Borunda, next month will be Dr. Wassmer, and then in January you'll probably see us do some collaborative work. So if you're interested in that collaborative event, please tell your chair, and we'll do all the footwork, we'll do all the promotions, we'll do the recording. All you have to do is show up with your amazing work. Okay? So thank you so much for coming. We will put this on YouTube so that it will be available to folks across the world in perpetuity. And without further ado, Dr. Borunda, I'm so forward to your talking on the activity in the community. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for coming, folks. I wasn't sure if there was going to be anybody coming, so when I saw that the announcement actually went out to everybody on Monday, I got up early this morning to put together just sort of an overview. But what you're going to see essentially is a reflection of the work that done by myself, Krista Martinez-Alier, who is a graduate of our Doctorate in Educational Leadership Program, as well as the MSN Counseling Program. Myself as a core faculty member in a doctoral program, I've been very blessed to have research funds and the assistance of Samantha Britta Jacoby, who is not only an MS student in our program, Counseling Education, but because of her background in anthropology, has been very facilitative in the work that you're going to see here. So when we talk about embracing American Indian ways of educating, I'm not going to get into the work of Paulo Freire. I'm assuming that everybody here is well-versed, probably even more than I. However, you'll see the themes that are prevalent throughout the work that we are doing. And as we know, when we have praxis, it's not just about reflection, it's not just about dialogue, it's about action as well. Because otherwise, just to be writing, just to be presenting, and not doing anything is just a bunch of hot air, right? So what I'm actually leading this to in the scope of this presentation is for us to be able to look at the curriculum that is actually now out in at least one school being piloted as a result of this work. So the journal article that was published in our own doctoral journal looked at the assertion that incorporating American Indian ways of knowledge and orientation is not just good for American Indians, but it's good for everybody. And so you're going to see the theory that backs that up from everything from Mahler to Montessori that we assert within that journal article. So what we say is that American Indian culture, traditions, and practices are presented for their merit in promoting student learning within a K-12 educational institution. And we talk about merit, because if we know that any time a people have been conquered, have been colonized, that we tend to devalue them, right? We're thrown to the margins. What's talked about them in terms of historical records is always from the pen of the victor. And so what we know about American Indians has never been really brought to the forefront, and we'll be taking the comments later. So, I talk about five different developmental theorists, and McChrystal asserts that by valuing and promoting American Indian culture and practices, that we're going to have greater strides and not just impacting American Indians in classroom, yes, in American Indian students, but also with all students as well. So what's good for American Indian children is good for all children. And as we look at a philosophy in terms of how we're all here now together, that how do we incorporate a sense of welcomeness, integration, and inclusion for all people? So the assertion is part of the journal article, and I have copies of it here if anybody has not had an opportunity to receive the journal already. Right there, journal, could you pass the journal? And the application is actually a paper I'll be presenting next week in Washington, D.C. at the ASH conference. So essentially, what does this look like in action? So when we talk about disrupting both the processes due to conflicts of colonization, injustice, oppression, and their ongoing omission, as well as negative portrayals in media, historical records, and so forth. And then I'm going to show you samples of what's actually going on right now in terms of the implementation. Because when we look at October 12th, and people say, oh, that's Columbus Day. I call it Indigenous Peoples Day. Okay? And when we look at the Redskins, and we look at so much that is ingrained as part of our culture, but how do we go about deconstructing that? So we're taking the steps to make that happen. So let's assert the value, the merit of American Indian orientations. I have five theorists. Forbel, who talks about harmony and unity to the natural world. We know that when people came from the East, that they named this continent America, a female connotation from the patriarchal world, one in which it's there for the taking, right? And the sense of that there is endless, endless amount of resources. Well, we know that they aren't endless, and we are accepting them now. And so if we can enhance the child's sense of self within the world, they can recognize that the importance of living in harmony, and that all the resources that we have, if we don't steward them in an appropriate way, that we'll continue to see the problems that we're having even now, as in climate change and all the other challenges that we're having. Montessori looked at curriculum that placed children in the natural world. She thought that learning in nature produces greater learning outcomes, not separate, but integrated in the world, and not studying about nature through a computer. And so that essence that when you're out there hands-on in the environment, that you're going to be much more connected and engaged with the world once again. Werner talked about the enhancement of children's perceptual capacities. Just looking outside, if you're amongst the hills, the mountain, the multidimensionality, the trees, the depths, and what that does is stimulate the mind. So when you talk about geometry and you talk about engineering, that what's that like to actually have your hands on something? So when you look at, for example, the Miwok who construct their own roundhouses, and they actually take apart their roundhouses every generation or so. And not necessarily because there's anything wrong with the roundhouse, but the next generation doesn't have the opportunity to learn how to make one unless they're standing side by side with their elders to learn how to construct one again. When you're using engineering principles, geometry, cooperativeness, community, all the elements that we would teach in a class, sitting inside a classroom, maybe with open books and a teacher facilitating, they're learning out in a hands-on activity. And then Erickson talks about the disadvantage of extreme individualism, right? The sense that it's all about me and only me. When you have cooperativeness, you learn collectivism and interdependence, being able to work together, okay? And the benefits of, if Sylvia knows something and I don't know it, then maybe I can learn from that, and there's reciprocity and our sharing knowledge, and the both of us are better for it because it's shared knowledge and wisdom. And then Mahler, a sense of belonging derived from being in nature. When you look at children who are oftentimes mistreated by their peers, we talk about relational bullying, we look at how children often will even commit suicide at very early ages, that finding comfort and acceptance through being connected to nature in ways that won't deny them, that don't turn them away, that they're breathing in the air, and what they put out, carbon dioxide, is not taken by the trees and given back to them, that there's a connection that promotes that sense of unity. So these are the theories that we discussed in the article. So we talked about application. Now we talk about social justice. So interrupting cultural genocide, because we're looking at how is it that a population that has experienced genocide within their own communities, misrepresentation of their sacred symbols, how do we interrupt all those processes that are now so ingrained in our curriculum, in our culture here in the United States? So in this paper, which we'll be presenting next week in DC, we talk about the founding fathers. The founding fathers, many people don't even realize, and children aren't taught about, were actually the Iroquois nation. And Benjamin Franklin, I will give him credit for the fact that he was able to connect with people from the Iroquois nation who were getting very tired of dealing with all these different people who had landed upon their shores and having to deal with them separately, and suggested that they adopt their own confederacy, the model of the confederacy, as a people. And that's what happened. Okay? And yet, many children do not learn this, because when Europeans arrived, they had monarchies, they had all kinds of other systems that were actually not very favorable, which is why so many people ended up with them. Okay? So what we have in turn is a system that was taken from the people already here, and that's what we live under now today. It would be a great benefit if Native American children and all children were to know this. The mission system. In my second book, Speaking from the Heart, I talk about how I was able to learn that within my own family, on my father's side, that my grandparents were born into what's called the encomienda system. And when the Spaniards arrived in Veracruz and the eastern shores of Mexico, they claimed all the lands up to where we're standing now. The encomienda system was essentially a way by which to subjugate the people in what's now called Mexico. And people in turn had to be converted to Catholicism. They had to give up their language and their own spiritual practices. My grandparents were born into the system. Relayed to me through oral tradition, my father conveyed to me that if a person didn't do what they were told to do, and my father was born into people known as the Perepecha in Guanajuato, that they would beat you to death and you would die right there. And then they would bring others to finish the work. We essentially know that as slavery here in the United States. That same system was brought along with the missions. And with the mission system to have forced labor, to convert a people by subjugation through religion, as well as to assert presence into Alta California, which is what we're standing on now, was the intention of the missions. The fact that the missions were romanticized is something that our schools have been grappling with quite a bit, when our fourth grade teachers have to now have all children create a mission. And so you can imagine what that's like in terms of asking a child to say, let's build a concentration camp. Or you know what, those twin towers that are on fire? Let's replicate that. Not something that we would want to do. Okay? Nonetheless, they're a part of our history. And yet, when we ask children to do that, every year in the fourth grade curriculum, we're given them once again a curriculum that mandates oppression and superiority. So with that, what do we replace that with? And that's what we're leading to. The trails and many of the major sites of communities we travel and live on were forged by Native Americans. So when we talk about the De Anza Trail, the De Anza discovered this trail and came up and created the mission system. The trail was already there. Many of the roadways that we take, going across the east, going up and down the Americas, were already done. Okay, and merely people just followed the trails and often had Native American trail guides to lead them up this way. So when we look at, and then of course the Columbus myth. In my second book, I talk about retracing the steps of Jack Forbes. Jack Forbes was a professor of Native American Studies at UC Davis, passed away a few years ago. And in one of his books, he talks about how he had come across this publication, because Columbus was actually a bookseller, and the publication had written on the side how he had encountered these people who came from the West while he was in Galway, Ireland. So I was in Galway, Ireland about 4 years ago, and there is a little monument where Columbus stood, and what had some people had actually arrived on a canoe from the Americas. So what we can actually say is that Columbus didn't discover America, the Americans discovered Columbus, discovered Europe, okay? Little known fact, but if you get my second book, we talk about it there. And Jack Forbes discusses that as well. So when we look at inserting Native American orientations with primary source data, this is what we talk about, and this is one of the things that I'm presenting in DC. With a history of intergenerational storytelling, petroglyphs, and pictoglyphs, regional encounters with Natives reflect the languages of local tribes. There are primary sources that can expand on the role and contributions of Native Americans to the Americas. So what I'm going to take you to now, in terms of what does this look like, is the whole process of dialogue. And when we look at, okay, you're a teacher in fourth grade, third grade, and you've been teaching the missions and you know which one, but what can I claim, what can I say, because I have not been educated in anything different. So how to bridge that gap for teachers and to provide the information that has been vetted and approved by Native Americans and Native people. So my work with Crystal Martinez-Samir, who many of you know by now, she was just recently elected to Elgrove School Board. What many people don't know was that she also just accepted a position at UC Davis, and she would be, was it a staff affairs person for the Native American students there at UC Davis, and would be in charge of putting on their annual powwow, their Native American gathering. We're very proud of it. So looking at culture-responsive curriculum that's inclusive. So the problem for many years is the K-12 system has reflected a Eurocentric curriculum that focuses on gold rush and Spanish mission as a beginning of civilization in California. And I moved to Amador County a few years ago. And going through the museums and so forth, and meeting a lot of people who are involved with what they have on display, they're very cognizant of the fact that, yes, we know that life did not begin in 1849. But who are we to tell the Native American story? Native Americans, sacred sites and so forth, we have Chausse, which is the California Indian Grinding Rock State Park out in Pine Grove. For them, those things that are found, the artifacts and so forth, that may be at a particular location, are supposed to stay there. So you can see this polarities of understanding and perceptions. We want to be able to educate people who are tourists, who come to Amador County, they're coming from Germany, they're coming from China, they come all from all over the world. And what they see is the gold rush era, the 49ers, and a lot of winemaking. Okay? Okay. Unless you have a connection with the Native American community, you're not going to have access to the sacred sites or know what's even out there. Okay? So how do you access that information? On Saturday, while I was actually in the right there in Sutter Creek, they have an office of tourism. And I, for the first time, I actually saw a grinding rock. Portable grinding, it's a bowl, beautiful, that somebody had donated. In Native American tradition, that would actually be blessed and given by the community to people for demonstration, for others to learn from. So how do you now bridge this gap is the question, and that's what I've been running into. How do you address the fourth grade initiatives project and pioneer days at schools? So, we know that multiple sources of documentation can speak to the fact that civilization already existed here way before European contact And we have stories, mythologies, they call them, but they're all traditions that are, that take us to a time where the place where we're standing right now is mixed underwater, or perhaps even several times underwater. Okay, those stories have been captured. And what should be included in culturally responsive curriculum in the K-12 public education system? So Crystal and myself, along with the support of our research assistant, the support we get through the doctoral program, we presented twice at California Indian conferences, once here in Sacramento, and the Fortune Sacramento hosted last year. A couple of weeks ago, we were down in San Bernardino presenting at the California Indian Conference. So we're essentially having a dialogue with California Indians about what we're doing. As somebody who's not a, quote, California Indian, but somebody who identifies with my indigenous identity, I understand when I see the presenters speak with sadness, with tears, because for them, what has happened is very recent. When they continue to see the Columbus, the Pioneer Days, the Redskins, when they have their sites desecrated and parking lots built over cemeteries, the examples can go on and on. And it's continuous for them. So reversing this, so that as a title of the conference we attended just about 3 weeks ago called Silence Voices, that we give them a voice, was for Crystal and I an opportunity to say, this is what we're trying to do. We're trying to get into the classrooms, but we need to know from you what needs to be conveyed and how to convey it. So we've been vetting the material. The proposed curriculum, looking at geography and cosmology of the ancients, and the ancients, because we know that, for example, the Miwok, we can claim them in particular regions where they are now, the Wintu, the Chumash, the Ohlone, and so forth. However, people move around, okay? We have people who are Irish American, and they're here, but they weren't always here. They were in Ireland, okay? They come from different parts of the world. Similarly, people here now have been moving around, and they have that information based on a larger tradition. So the Miwok origin stories, and I'm talking particularly to work in Mandeville County. Place names. Names like McColony, Consumus, Calusa. Those are all Native American terms, Tuolumne. And what does that mean? And I would bet you that most children don't even know that those words are derived from California Indians. Their economic, and then of course the archaeological sources, economics and politics, culture and trade. Those, the quote, the Anza Trail. Okay, who's taking those trails? Okay, why is it that we can find shells that you would get from the California coast over in New Mexico? Why is it that you would have feathers that you would find only maybe deep down in Central America, Mexico, up in the California region? People were going back and forth and trading. So, and then, of course, the contact. So when we talk about the missions, our point of view is to talk about the resistance, the destruction, and, of course, the accommodation. In the sense that when we talk about California Indians, we talk about Miwok or other tribes, you know what? They're still here. Okay, so they're not some group of people that, you know, here's a grinding bowl, here's a tool, here's an artifact for us to examine, and now they're all gone and we move on. No, they're still here, and have retained elements of their culture. So we talk about communities today. Physical evidence of Native American inhabitants. We have access to undisclosed sites in which we can access and learn more about what was written literally on the rocks. In the Sierra foothills, we have strong physical evidence of California Indians having existed for a long time, when much of California was covered by a vast sea. Anybody can have a sense of when the area that we're standing in was covered by water? How many years ago that was, perhaps? Becky up there? Yeah, it would still flood in the 1800s. Yeah. Uh-huh. So in essence, when it was all, this was a sea? Yeah. I have my research assistant looking that up right now, having to uncover that. It's not in our immediate knowledge base, right? It's not in our immediate knowledge base. Yeah, this area, so this whole valley, Sacramento, San Joaquin Valley, being completely underwater and part of the sea. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So California Indian Valley lived here for thousands of years, so that's how deep their history was. But left word record of their presence and their observation. These are valid sources of documentation, right? Primary documentation. Look at the creation story. When water covered the world, only the top of the highest mountain rose above it. The people had climbed up on this mountain, but could find no food and were starving. They wanted to go off and get something to eat. When the water went down, all the ground was soft mud. After a while, the people rolled rocks down to see if the mud would cover them to hold it. And the rocks stayed on top, the people were there to fish for food. But the mud was not hard enough to hold it, and they sank out of sight, leaving deep holes where they had gone down. Then Kapali, the ravens, came and stood at the hole, one of each hole where a man had gone down. After a while, when the ground caught it, the ravens turned into people. This is the reason the demon has been dead. Give you a sense. People go into the high road. You look at Mount Diablo, you look at the Sierras, you look at some of the highest, some of the areas in which we would know that people would have gone to while the water was rising. So the Miwok stories speak to the rising of the water and also the repeating of the world after the flood. Our source, Thomas Williams, a Sierra Miwok. So oral tradition is a major source of history. Stories were formally related at night in the circular circuit houses of the Miwok. Certain men dressed in myths often traveled from village to village, telling the tales in the circuit house of each village. So what do we call that in terms of education? Where they become? As people are telling the history, oral tradition, oral history. Okay? So here we have, you see this figure here, they're coming. But I'm blaming myself. Right here, you can see, you see a headdress, you see the eye, you have the mouth that is open. Now, at this site, the Miwok families have visited, including medicine men from the Miwok Iron Band, former tribal leader and other elders, to validate what we have written on stone here. They told me that a lot of this, that some of this was not all necessarily Miwok, so they asked that that we bring somebody from one of the southern south of the border tribes. So we had access to someone by the name, we call her Mama Cobb in Burnley, but her name is actually on her bed, but Cobb. And when she came to the side, and I said, I could tell that the mouth is open. And she said, he's singing. He's singing. So later, the research assistant Samantha Bader Jacoby was looking at information related to Miwok traditions and stories, and it was captured by some of the anthropologists in the late 1800s, early 1900s. This is where we found this quote here. And this was published. So certain men versed in the myths traveled from village to village, telling the tales in the sacred house of each village. Such a frontier was known as a Uthinka, a name derived from Uthman, a myth. Each Uthinka was paid for his services, his audience presented him with baskets, beans, berries, and food. Thomas Williams, who was formerly Uthinka, said the Victorian myth often took all night. But frequently, the notion of traffic hits the scene the open mind. So how would you convey this, right? If you're going to write this in the wrong, how would you convey this to future generations? Not infrequently, the nurses chanted. Each nurse of a chanted of holy ordinary prose is accompanied by the songs of the various characters. For example, in the story of Harry Potter's marriage, there are three songs, one sung by Harry Potter, one by his wife, and one by his mother. This is Thomas Williams. And so before his passing, we have Gifford who recorded a number of his stories in which he talks about the tradition of the adventure and actually recorded the stories that are associated with three different eras in which we recognize that we were all in the water at one point and then what happened afterwards. So Thomas Williams of Gateshaw delivered 11 stories between 1913 and 1914. These stories were published after being translated into English, word for word, and reproduced in New York. These stories are in Berkeley. I haven't had a chance to go to UCB and hang out there, but my understanding is a lot of the work of Craig Billy Winslow Gifford is held there in the archives of UC Berkeley. We're going to revisit these right here. These also come from the site. You can make that animal. Can you make that a gallery type right here? Mm-hmm. Okay, the buffalo too, right here. You know what, my research assistant has a little bit more knowledge on that. My background not being anthropology. What was fascinating is that when we went to the California Indian Conference several weeks ago and talking with the California Indians who were attending, we had a number who are now in their area. They are doing their own education, and the frustration with many California Indians, because their records and their children are not doing well in the public schools, those who are connected with perhaps some of the wealthier nations due to a number of funding sources, whether it's casinos or whatnot, they're starting their own schools. And so when I told them what we were doing here, he talked about how they have lesson plans now, where they talk about the pigments and what they're able to use, what they use to make them. And so kids now are able to do petroglyphs and so forth now. And they were willing to share that with public school teachers, as well as how they made acorn mush and the chemistry of it. So you're looking at science and then having, I've got zillions of acorns on my property right now. I don't know what to do with them yet because I'm not from an acorn culture. Nonetheless, people lived off of the acorns at one time. And so to have the science and the integration of those units in our science practice would be wonderful, and this is what they're offering. Here you can see, if anybody's familiar with the Seattle Seahawks, very similar to Falcon there. Right here you can see turtle. We have a face right here, you can look at this guy. Another face you can see this guy. This right here is a huge bird. It stands about 6 to 7 feet tall. This is between is about 3 to 4 feet wide, crawls right into the ground. Looks like a burning shark. And here, is anyone living buffalo over here in California? Somebody saw them and recovered it here. So giving us an indication of what they have in their world. So when we talk about how we change the curriculum in our public schools, we look at the evidence that we have here. That's the one thing we are looking to describe. And when we talk about California Indian Agency, so we still talk about the missions, but what was the response to now people that are coming onto our land? They're enslaving our people. And despite how oftentimes when you go to the missions and the way that it's put across as these happy Indians are being fed, and thank God that these missionaries came and saved them from their nakedness and in a very condescending, very belittling, and making a record that makes it look as if the California Indians were heathens. Yet when we look at the record of what we left in time, here you see, can you see that? Can you make that up? That's a big, right? What culture did you see that from? You see the whole face here, this is the right there. You see that earlobe, the earring. You see the headdress right there. Okay. So, California Indian, perhaps, looks like it. Okay. Here, you can see the hat. You see the beard. This right here is a feather. Our cultural expert, Rebecca Cobb, she called this La Pluma Royal, which is translated as the royal feather, somebody of stature. So Samantha, she looked at the picture of when the first Spaniards to come in there. Oh, on the Anza. A picture of the Anza. I've seen another picture of him, and he has this kind of hat. No, there's half the year at graduation, not the mortarboard, but the other one. These are the Stanford guys and all these guys have kind of That's this kind of hat, okay? And this one he's using it at the end of work, and then he's just seeing the human variety of the real food. So imagine if he was wearing the kind that some of our colleagues wear, and then the thing would go down the side. So here, we have a story, folks, because right here, you see him right there? That's him, right there. Story? He's got his back to him. He's a fantasia. I see you. If you don't know that I see you, because your back is turned to me. But now that I see you, I can go back and tell others that you're here. Okay? But the story is up. Here? Before the email, folks, there was lockdown. Alright? You see the shield right here? You see the shield? The helmet. So I see this, I carve it, I give it to Jenny. Jenny, you go tell your tribe who's here and what they're doing here. This is what I saw, this is what I experienced. We need to organize, we need to get our people together. The resistance movement started with one of the very, very first missions in San Diego. Okay? People were fighting, people were working together. To try to uproot what was coming. Here, you see the clearing of faces now. Okay? The people were communicating. Place names, as we discussed earlier. You look at some of the names that are here. Cartoonists had no idea that was from the region. Cafe. In Capitol. The singers. The salmon that comes from the plains, Miwok, Kedusa, it's in the Cutland tribe. So you can recognize all these different names, Quechua. You can learn, they have a whole other thing. So we're breaking these names down so that we have the area specific. And again, these are just the ones that Samantha was able to locate right out of California. Susa colleagues, I have no idea that was a little bit. Malibu, I don't think we even have, do we still have too much living here? And then by the stars, I think it's a beautiful place here. Yeah? Yeah. But I think we have Native American as well. To correct the historical record, where we're moving, so we talk about praxis, it's not just about talking, it's not just about writing journal articles and presenting at conferences. It's also, for us, been about bridging. So at this time, we're working with teachers at Mandeville County Elementary School to develop a pilot curriculum that only includes local cultural infrastructures, but draws from the sources that we've been talking about for the last half hour. So what we did is we had an opportunity again in San Bernardino to talk with California Indians. We presented this information to them, and ask them what their thoughts were. Pretty much got validation that when California Indians left their history on the rocks, they wanted their story told. So what we did was we brought three teachers and the principal. Cedar Creek Elementary went out to the site, so they know the source, they got to see it for themselves. We have a number of images that we're now using and have put together lesson plans. Part of this effort, we've now brought in other people. Many of you are familiar with Mimi Coughlin, who is out of teacher ed, and Mimi is working with us in terms of the Common Core standards of how to write the curriculum in such a way that teachers can get the information and apply it right into the classroom. Also have brought in Michelle Lorimer, who we met down in San Bernardino. She's a professor in history, and her specialization of her dissertation will be published next year by Great Oaks Publishing Company, focuses on how it is that the missions became as romanticized as they are. And basically what she points at is a tourism focus, and again, an attempt to connect with a European past as opposed to a California Indian past, which there's multiple layers of oppression and racism associated to that. So we've brought her in to also look at the curriculum that we put together. So what we start at with the centering in this curriculum, and this has already been sent on, it's in a pilot format right now, is exploring California Indian knowledge and teaching about our region. So we look at the sources of things such as, and let me put this up for you. So a pictograph, and you can see here the dyes that we've used, the pigments, and we have essentially a figure here. When you see sort of little animal right there, and you get the picture you can kind of walk out the sun. A pictoglyph, and by now the children have already learned the definitions and the difference between the two. We have an authentic, so they learn the importance of storytellers and California Indian traditions. They learned about Thomas Williams. They looked at a pan fossil. This was taken from that property, which is about 900 feet in the Sierra foothills, which tells us that the sea went up that high at one point. So the children are able to look from the hills and look towards Mount Diablo towards the west and try to envision what it was like before there were people other than their own communities who appeared, and how long did it take for the water to recede, and what was life like for them. You can see salt lines right here. So why would they use salt at 900 feet elevation? So this is all given something, this has all been given to the elementary teacher. Here you can see a bird and a fish right here. Might be a buffalo, I'm not sure, but it might be a rabbit as well. You could have seen big ears up there. There's that turtle again, and there's the buffalo. So, with that, you're getting a sense of the curriculum rolling out. At this time, and just on Monday, I sent out the next series of lesson plans to Dr. Coughlin for her to look at it and to look at how we can use place names and some of the other images that we want to integrate so that children are able to expand their knowledge of California way before the Gold Rush. And understanding that when we talk about 1849, that in terms of the historical record, that that's just like this amount of time in a span of existence that's been right here in California. So for us to now roll this out, we want to get feedback from the educators, how it's been implemented, the feedback they have. At the conference in San Bernardino, one of the organizers asked about the possibility of next year having a four-hour forum. And those of you who put on conferences before know that's a lot of time. But they possibly have these California teachers along with the California Indian educators working together, inviting other California public school educators, and look at how we can now share our curriculum so that what's being taught to California Indians, not just in Cedar Creek, but also in Southern California, now starts to spread. So if my child goes to school in Malibu, that they're going to be learning about the Chumash before they learn about Bobby Spicer, right? Okay? So looking at that, the historical record needs to be inclusive of the people that will have that one reference. Yes, and to the greatest extent possible. And we know that there are many tribes that are no longer here, right? And many were annihilated. But as close as possible to the accurate records that we can provide, what we learned that when we went to San Bernardino, for example, was that one of the tribes, the Yurok, which is where this necklace comes from, that they've been working with geologists and learning that there was a 10.0 earthquake that hit this region of the world. And so that we actually had two major floods. You can imagine the annihilation of people way even before the gold rush came, right? And people dying through disease and other heinous ways. But if we can get those stories, if we can get the nearest tribe that can provide us with what we know, as well as archaeological evidence, then what we can reconstruct, at least for children to have an essence of a respect and connectedness and gratefulness to the world, is what we're looking for. Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yes, you know, these lines that delineate states and nations and so forth, that's all new stuff. In fact, what I have just recently put together and sent off to be vetted by Mimi and others consists of those people that are going back and forth between Mexico, Central America, South America, and all the way up and down. There were no national boundaries. You didn't have to check them at the border and ask if you had a passport, right? So with that, we're opening up the whole understanding of the trails that were already there. Yeah. And there were a lot of similarities and also differences between tribes. So hopefully you're right, and what you're leading to, which is my hope, is an understanding of the Americas before contact, before Columbus, and the vibrance of it was here, and still here to some extent. So I wanted to give time for the questions and to be able to share your thoughts. I just wanted to share the one image. This is the one I just sent out on Monday. These are the Tzcatas. The Tzcatas were essentially merchants who would travel up and down the trails. You can see they're carrying the goods on their back. And so you can see the ancient trail that they're following, going from one community to another. Any questions? Any thoughts? Observations? Yes.
Mm-hmm. I'm thinking about, you know, resources that you can have And it seems like, you know, Native Americans now have the resources of the community. They can be quite large profits and have the resources that they're using anyway to make profits. The new movements, how they approach, you know, Native Americans, the only thing that was asking for the issues is having them better.
Yeah, and it's interesting because, you know, our legislature has already passed a bill that talks about inclusion, right? But what I found is that for the educators, for them to have the training, to have the resources, you know, they don't have it. And that's why when we were asked just sort of informally about the possibility when our conference will be in Berkeley next year to try to coordinate the California Indian educators who have their own private schools funded by casino money and other such money, to have them interacting with public teachers, that's an opportunity right there. And it could be that, yeah, we may have to do some larger funding to get the word out and to host conferences to be able to disseminate this sort of information, as well as just that opportunity for people to come together and learn from one another. And recognize that being a sensitive topic, that it